Good evening, everybody. This is Prospector Jess from huntingforgold.com. I'm beginning another broadcast tonight on Facebook. We'll be broadcasting these things across multiple platforms, so it won't just be associated with Facebook. It'll be Facebook and YouTube, as well as other platforms such as our blog, sourdoughminer.com and huntingforgold.com. You'll want to check in every time you get to find out what's new and what's happening. Tonight, we have a new topic I wanted to cover, and that's using watersheds and gold. So just for your information, watersheds are a topic we hit on last night, talking about where and how you would start to find gold. One of the important things to keep in mind in flood season, such as what we're having right now, and I'll go into that in a minute, is to know about your local watersheds. Now, what is a watershed? Let's take a quick look. You can find out more about this kind of thing. Go Google it. Let me zoom in a little bit here. So watershed, an area or ridge of land that separates waters flowing to different river basins or seas. An event or a period marking a turning point. That's not really what we're talking about here. We're talking about this first one, which is an area or ridge of land that separates waters flowing to different rivers, basins, or seas. Now, what does that mean? What's the long and the short of it? Let me draw you a little bit of a picture. But the idea here is last night we talked about how rainstorms flooding an area can move gold. Well, I want to go into elaboration a little bit more on the subject of a watershed and the role it plays in that, how it amplifies flooding and flooding moves gold. So we're looking again at why. Now, why do we look at these things? Because that dictates the root cause. Knowing the root cause of something allows you to understand when things change, what you can do about it. So you'll find me really pushing this why, because it's important to understand the whys behind things so that you can find more gold as you explore further into this great adventure of prospecting and hunting for gold. So let's take a look. Let me draw a picture here and see if this is going to work correctly. What I have is a little whiteboard that I'm demonstrating to you on. And the idea is to kind of give you an idea what a drainage basin would look like. So we have a major stream that comes in as a tiny little thread and works its way, meanders down, and let's say this is the ocean here. And the ocean, you know, is just full of water. Everything flows to the sea. But notice, not everything flows directly to the sea. It oftentimes will flow in from another branch. They call this dendritic growth. And so you'll have multiple streams that feed a single river. And these streams will come from sometimes long distances, like a secondary river. And that itself will have other branches that will feed in. This is what they call a dendritic format, or a mossy growth kind of structure. It looks like a tree, okay, with the base in the ocean. So the idea is that if I take this and kind of mark it up this way, you can kind of see how each of these branches feeds downstream and then down to the next branch and then down eventually to the river, into the ocean where it pools, or into a lake where it pools. Anywhere it pools, it drops velocity. That's where gold drops out. Keep that in mind, very important fact. But what's really worth note right now is if I have a simple river basin, we'll call it, not so simple looking as you can see now, but let's say I change color of my pen to mark it in red, and now I'm going to surround this with kind of a red outline. Anything that falls in a rainstorm along this red outline will essentially drain into this watershed. This red area is a watershed, and as it branches into the lower parts of the stream, each stream feeding it adds together. We call it integration. It adds on top of the previous stream flow. What does that mean to you? Floods. Because the further downstream you go, the more these things feed in. For example, right now, we're expecting tonight to get some atmospheric river conditions here in California that will lead to potential flooding in areas that had burns. For example, the coastal area might get 1 to 3 inches right now over the next 24 hours. Inland toward the mountains or along the shore in the Santa Monicas, where they had all those burns this last year, the Thomas Fire and the various other fires that we had going on, that is going to cause a lot of serious flooding. And what I mean by that is that when you take 1 to 3 inches and you integrate it over this area, which might be 100 square miles, that's a lot of water, okay? In the case of the Thomas Fire, I think it was 150 square miles or something. I might be wrong on that number, but you get the idea. It's huge. And it's many, many streams and many different rivers even. The main one coming out of that system will be the Ventura River coming out of Ojai via Route 33. So what happens is when this flooding takes place, it's caused because of the water that drops in this region. Right now, what they're expecting tonight might be as high as 4 to 7 inches in the mountainous regions of the Thomas Fire. And some of the areas along the Santa Monicas, which had the, what's the name of that other fire? It'll come to me. So anyway, the idea is these regions that have floods integrate that, you know, half a foot of water into a very tiny region, maybe several hundred or to 1,000 feet wide. Well, guess what? That means that that river is going to go into flood stage and beyond, maybe 15, 20 feet deep, moving at hundreds of thousands of cubic feet per second. Well, hundreds of thousands of cubic feet per second from those distances, you know, you're talking about gigawatts of power, billions of watts, you know, a nuclear power plant on full tilt or more. And what does that do along these lower reaches or any of these other sub-reaches that have enough flow is it's going to gouge out any of the soils. It's going to deposit things downstream. It's going to move rocks, boulders, houses, you name it, if you don't look out. And so what happens is when that activity takes place, we see another thing that takes place, and that is the redeposition of gold. And so as we start seeing that happen, there might be a deposit of gold up here that might be just sparsely, you know, in these areas. And when the river cuts, it'll move all that material downstream and perhaps redeposit it in some of these regions. And that becomes interesting to you as a prospector, because up here it might not be very fruitful to find gold. It's just too widespread. But if it starts to remove a lot of material and move it downstream rapidly, as it would in these floods, which would take place in less than 24 hours, you know, they're expecting, for example, tonight we might get a couple periods where we get 1 to 2 inches an hour. When that takes place on this large a scale of an area, as a steep a slope as these things are, the water in these regions in the intermediate streams, it gets explosive. So what we're going to do is focus on showing you the reasons why it's important to know about these floods and what they do to redeposit this stuff downstream into nice gold-bearing areas using the helical flow effect and some of the other stuff I cover in the 2020 prospecting thing I've been pointing out, the product. It's important to understand how this stuff bears on gold and what it will do to concentrate the gold. A couple of things I can give you in terms of tips. Anytime gold slows down in one of these floods, anytime that water slows even a little bit, the big gold drops first. The lighter gold doesn't drop until, it may not drop at all in a flood like this. Whereas in some conditions, if it raises the water and then brings it down and just moves flower gold, it might deposit, typically it'll deposit in a region that where the water slows a lot. Let's say there were a big pool down in here, and it might deposit on the back end of that as flower gold. And the reason is, it's the last thing to settle out. It settles out with the silt. Whereas these other deposits might only deposit in the torrent because it's the only thing strong enough to move a big chunk of gold, a big fat nugget. And so what you're looking for in these conditions is, you know, how does it affect, you know, finding those big fat nuggets, and where downstream can I look to find them? And so when you look at these dendritic forms of watershed, you can understand quickly how the gold will drop out. So you want to map that information along with your gold finds, put the two together, and now you've got yourself a map, or your beginnings of a map. Because of course, the other thing you want to do is sample. We talk about that elsewhere. But for now, it's important to understand that concept of floods and how it moves gold. We cover that in 2020 prospecting. And you know, you can find that in sourdoughminer.com 2020, and there's a hyphen in the 2020 here. Probably should correct that. Let's see if I can do that right now. Do some magical correction on the fly so that everybody can see the right answer. And there you go. So 20-20 is how you get there. And that's important because we want to make sure you can find it. So in there, I talk about more of these concepts of floodwaters and gold and give you some information on where to go look. So this is Prospector Jess, huntingforgold.com. Another night's video, quick turnaround. I wanted to talk to you guys and make sure you were up to snuff on where we're going. Let me check to see if you got any comments right now. We'll check in on the Facebook fan page. The dogs are going to check in while we're at it. Apparently something's going on. We have 20 some odd people watching. Great. Glad to have you. It's Friday night, and this is getting to be kind of fun. We're going to do this on a regular basis and just see where it takes us. It's a big adventure to find gold. So let's see what we got. We got a couple comments. Wesley says, I found mine on an uprooted tree root system after a dammed up on the dam on the upper American River in a landslide. See, that landslides come from this kind of water activity. They also come from unstable land that's saturated with water. So what happens, there's several different classes of landslides. We can go into that, and we probably will later. But the idea is that landslides are basically a sign of instability caused by saturation with water. It can also be affected by fires and some of the same things that affect flooding. So it's important to recognize that when you have these problems, you can go after them and stay out of the areas when they're wet and flooding and when there's landslide potential. But after all that clears up, that can be a really good place, as he pointed out, where he can find some serious gold. Vic says he's very knowledgeable. Thank you, Vic. I appreciate that. Let's see. Wesley says, used to watch how the creeks and the Khyber Pass ran after the fires in California. Yep, and you're going to see that. Sadly, the Paradise area is a mess, but that's one of those areas that's probably going to be having some serious gold appearances. Same thing up in the upper area of Tuolumne County. We had a big fire up there, the Rim Fire, a couple of years back. And by the way, it doesn't mean that fire this last year. It could be over the last decade, because fires take a while to grow back, and the roots and the depth of the roots is what determines what holds the soils in place. Once those roots give way, the rocks and boulders are going to move. And if there's enough water, like there will be this flood up in the Thomas Fire area tonight, you know, that's going to move gold. Piru Creek, all those areas up in there. Now, there's a whole other thing about how the laws and everything regulate you on those places. So you got to make sure you have access rights if you can get them. But the fact is that there's going to be gold moving no matter what. It doesn't matter what the law says. It's what the laws of nature say and what God says about that. So tonight's going to be an interesting time. Stay safe. Let's see. That's it for right now. Anybody have any more questions? We have 15 people on. So it's good to see you guys. I'm glad you're joining me. We're going to have a lot of fun. Last night, we did this first initial broadcast in a sequence. What we're going to be doing is just trying to hit you up with a 10-20-minute video every night for as long as we can. And as long as you got questions and as long as I got answers, we'll keep going at it. And I will get other people on as we go. I've had people in the past. I had Pat Keene on a while back talking about desert gold. He told me he'd be willing to come back and talk some more about detecting and desert gold. We should do that one. And I'm going to be talking more about this topic. Again, 2020 prospecting is available. You can see the thing below. Go there. I'll put a link on these video posts when they go up. And they do show up here on Facebook. They'll show up on YouTube, and they also show up on our blog post, and they'll be broadcast all over the place. That's the idea. Get the word out. Teach you how to find gold and have fun doing it. That's what we're about. Prospector Jess, huntingforgold.com. And I think this is a wrap for tonight. good prospecting, and good night. Stay safe. Stay dry.